about you, but I've already chose to rejoice.
Yeah.
And be glad in it. Amen. Because it started out bad doesn't mean it has to end bad. Come on. Praise the Lord. Doesn't matter what happens today, you are the thermostat.
That's
why I've had a bad week. Well, you got tomorrow. Come on. You still got the rest of tonight. Praise the Lord. I want to thank Pastor Michael and Monica for their wonderful hospitality, picking me up all the time, taking me back and forth to the airport, never complaining, laughing at all my corny jokes. Sometimes I think they halfway like them. Or they're just under a grace. Amen.
Yeah.
No, but I don't know if Pastor John and Pastor Karen are watching by YouTube or not, but I just honestly thank them for the opportunity to always come. I don't take it for granted. I just still amazed. August was 22 years full time.
Amen.
And the Lord is still opening doors.
Yes.
Amen. Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
And I would covet your prayers. I leave tomorrow, then Saturday I fly to Nashville, drive up to Western Kentucky, minister two wonderful churches like this one, and then come back to Nashville. And then 2 days later, Wednesday, I fly to San Jose, Costa Rica. And then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, I'm doing a faith conference. I found out, I think I'm the only speaker. Then you get nervous. You're like, what? I thought I had 3.5 hours. Yeah, it's all yours. No, Thursday, Friday, there might be other speakers. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, they give me 3.5 hours each day.
Wow.
And then Sunday, I got, I told them as many churches they want me preaching on Sunday, I'll do it. And then Monday, I catch a plane out early and head home. Amen?
Amen.
And starting it all over on Wednesday. Amen? How many knows the wheels on the airplane go round and round? Amen?
That's right.
You're like, I just go like that. It's on the bus. Well, I don't take the bus. The airplane gets me there faster. Amen. Praise the Lord. But let's start. I want to get some things covered this evening. I didn't get this morning. If you got your Bibles, let's go back to James chapter 1. James chapter 1, 2 Peter chapter 3. And verses 1 through 4. Now, I want to minister on staying on. How many knows we got to stay on course in order to finish your course?
Yeah.
You know, the Bible, you know, tells us in Jeremiah 29:11 that God's given us a future and a hope. In other words, an expected end.
Right.
Now, we're supposed to expect to end up somewhere in the will of God. Amen?
Right. Amen?
And it's supposed to be at the end of your race. You're supposed to finish your course, keep the faith, fight the good fight.
Yes.
But in order to do that, then you're going to have to learn to stay on course, much like these car rentals. I love to do car rentals, and when I do them, I like to throw them off. When I say love it, I really enjoy kind of throwing some of these people off their sell pitch because they're always trying to upgrade them.
Yeah.
And which is fine. I mean, that's part of their job. And they said, well, you'd like a GPS with that. I said, no, thank you. I can get lost by myself. And you know, and a lot of them, some of them are not updated, amen?
Yeah.
I mean, if you're on a half-mile bridge, it's telling you to turn to the left at 100 feet. You know there's something wrong. Is anybody here? Amen.
Yeah.
All right, praise the Lord. Oh, my God, I was on the same bridge as he was. But anyway, what's the word? Well, here's what I like is when that voice comes on and says, in 100 feet, please make a right-hand turn. You're thinking, you're not the boss of me. So sometimes you just pass it to prove to them that you are boss.
Yeah.
And the moment you pass it, what does it say? What's the one word?
Yeah.
Recalculating. I've loved this word over the last couple of years. I've used it in so many different sermons. But the thing is we always have to recalculate. And there's times, every time you have to be still. Jesus recalculated in prayer a lot. You know, if you read about him in the scriptures and different things, in the parables and what happened before and after, he was always with the Father in prayer and afterwards with the Father in prayer. Why? He was always recalculating. Now, we're going to touch on the life of Jesus a little bit tonight, and we're going to touch on the life of Paul. Now, the thing about Jesus, a lot of people probably don't realize, and I'm not saying I know it all, is Jesus did not just come to fulfill the will of God for his life. He came to fulfill what the first Adam was supposed to do.
Yeah.
And then came to establish a better new covenant by fulfilling the old covenant. So there was a multitude of things that Jesus had to do. And I like what Pastor Michael said. You know, he said, I'm not giving the devil an inch, but if I make an inch, then what you do is you're maintaining what you've obtained. Amen?
Yeah.
You know, how many knows you got to hold your position until it changes your condition?
Yeah.
Amen? I like saying that. You got to hold your position until it changes your condition. Now, when I was growing up, we had a lot of different things that a lot of kids today don't have. So I'm going to say something to that here in a few minutes, that only about a half of you are going to smile and shake your head and go, "Oh, my Lord, yes." And the other half is just going to smile and say, "I have no clue what he's saying." Amen? Right. And we'll figure out the age difference here in a minute of where that cutoff is. But, you know, when we were growing up, we didn't have seatbelt laws, and we didn't have a lot of different things, and we didn't have iPads, and we didn't have all the little monitors came down with the headphones, and we didn't have all the creative things. We had crayons that, if they weren't melted, you could still use them in your crayon book. And we didn't break pillows because we were using the sleep on. We just made it to level out the middle floorboard so the center axle would be the only thing sticking up. If we wanted to take a nap, it wasn't before, it was on the seat, it was in the back of the window. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, who needs a seatbelt? Amen?
Right.
Come on.
Right.
So, but now we got, you know, now this generation that I'm living in, which is great, I think all technology is wonderful and stuff like that. But my mother would send me out sometimes, and if it was around noon, it's like, okay, you've used your restroom, you've been fed. It's 12:30. I don't want you back in this house until 4:30. You got a big enough yard, and if you get in trouble, now somebody either has to be dying, bleeding to death, you have to have a limb missing. Come on now. Yeah, but what are we going to do? This is where our mother downloaded an app in our head. You know what it's called? Imagination.
Yes.
Come on. We had to go out and just imagine things. I said, "Well, how would I know if it's 4:30? She said, "Well, when I come out, then you'll know it's time to come in." She said, "But just go out and have fun and get your friends." And man, we did. Man, we did capture the flag. We did cops and robbers and cowboys and Indians. I mean, we did everything. I mean, we did secret missions. And,
yeah.
Man, we went out and found that old wood and different things. Ended up making halfway decent free houses, and come on. Yeah, when we didn't have no wood, we got out, got shovels, and dug holes, and then put wood over the hole, and then crawled in it. Then had to have people pull us back out because we didn't make it big enough to turn around in. Amen. The reason I say that is there's a lot of things that's going on in the world, but one thing that I noticed is my wife, she is real good at puzzles, and my little boy, they're both good at math. My wife can, on an hour flight, do a 250-piece puzzle. It's nothing. She just goes. And I mean, it's like she has a microchip. But when I was growing up, what I had was, I didn't have all these little games and different things like that. You know, my little boy and I, about 3 weeks ago, took us about a 750-mile trip in 28 hours. We went all the way up 2 hours west of Jackson Hole, Wyoming. We went to this church, and we had a great time. We ate at the church. We got back to the hotel 20 after 12. There's not a lot to do in Big Piney and Marbleton, Wyoming. So we just stayed at the church and had fun, man. Come on.
Yeah.
But my little boy had a fort in the back of the van. He had all his, he was seatbelted in, but he had his games, had his books and everything. But what was so funny was the other day had this little thing come home that I used to have on those long road trips too, besides crayon books. You know what it was? It was those little things that you had to connect the dots. You go to about 1 to 15 and it's not too bad. Then all of a sudden you get bored because it's so minute. You had to connect the little dots. And my little boy brought one of those home one time because when I was doing it, I was like, "Why is this? This is just too hard, Mom. I mean, Dad, I mean, look at this. They got all these numbers bunched in there. And it's just almost impossible to connect it without crossing each other." So then you get impatient, you just draw your own thing. And when you flick it to the back of the book, it doesn't look like nothing like the author's picture. So my mom would say, "Hold on, let me help you a little bit." Or my dad, and they sit there and I said, "Look, just draw it real easy. Take your time. If you get frustrated, put it down, stop, come back. But you got to connect every dot, 26, 27, 28. And I said, "Why is this necessary?" Because it's important for that final outcome.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing my little boy almost asked me. Think about that. That's amazing how the next generation asked me the same thing. He brought that little thing home. I said, "Oh, we used to do this growing up." So he started going, and he got that little thick part. He goes, "Dad, I just don't." I said, "Okay, just put it down, walk away from it." I said, "If you need me to help you, I'll help you." He said, "But why is that necessary? Look at all these numbers." I went, "Because it's necessary for the final outcome of the picture." Amen. Then we got up there, and I would say, "Well, look, they don't even have nothing after 34. And he said, well, you got to look outside a little bit. You're too narrow-minded right now. You got to look out. So I look out, and there'll be 35 way over here. You know, my little boy got frustrated. I think his was 27. He said, well, Dad, look, they didn't even put 27 here. I'm just going to go to 28. No. That's important because of the final outcome. I said, where is it? I said, you got to look a little bit beyond the picture. Look a little bit out. And he goes, there it is. He goes, why? Come on now. Why is it so important that he put this thing where? Why? I said, because it's important for the final outcome. Now, are y'all catching this? But the thing is when we got done, we hit 100 and we did it right. Now, there was times that we had to take an eraser on several occasions and go back and do it. You know, it's all right, we skipped one here, let's go back. Dad, I said, Evan, it's going to be so much worth it when you get done. We got done and we flipped back to the back of the book and I said, now look at this. They both look the same. I said, don't you feel better? And he goes, can I go play? But I sat there and I thought about that. I thought that's what God has for us to do. Yeah. He wants us to connect the dots in our lives. Yes. And we got to stay on course. In order to hit the next dot, we've got to be patient enough. Because how many know some dots are real easy to hit and there's a lot of them together. But then there's some dots it takes a long time and a long patience to get next to it. Why? Because I found out finishing your course is not all the time about you finishing your course. Listen to this now. God strategically is bringing people into your life as He brings you into their life. And you're meeting due seasons and due times. And He's causing everything to work together for good to them that what? Love God. He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments and call according to my purpose. See, when we're about the Father's business in His house, let me tell you something. He's at your house taking care of your business. Come on now. God is doing something in front of you that you don't even realize what happened behind you. Come on, look, the windshield is a lot bigger piece of glass than the rearview mirror. And that's where we need to take hold and put our hand on the plow. Paul said, I press towards the mark.
Yeah.
Amen. And there's times when you sit there and if you don't watch it, you're going to get your focus upon the little piece of glass. And you're not going to see where you're going. Yes. And the only thing you'll see in front of you is your past.
Right.
Come on now. Right. God wants you to have a great future. Why? Because you're affecting other people's futures.
Yes.
This is not all about you. Because I found out in the whole scheme of plan, what God's trying to get in you and through you is not always necessarily for you. It's for the people around you. God really wants to show you all as advertisement of His covenant how much He loves and wants to bless His children. He said, if you just do what I tell you, He says, there not be one person to be able to stand up and mock me, your God, and say that I was not big enough to bring a harvest on your behalf personally. That's the paraphrase of God is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, he shall reap. Come on.
Amen.
There will not be one person to be able to stand up and mock your God and say he was not big enough. Why? It's not just in finances. It's in your words. I have people come up and say, I have no friends. And I go, well, that's your fault. They said, see, you don't even like me. I said, let me ask you this. When's the last time you smiled at somebody? When's the last time you looked somebody in the eye and was kind to them? They said, I don't know. I said, that's your fault. Because the Bible says in Proverbs, he who shows himself friendly makes friends. Come on now. There's times you're going to have to say no to some people and set limits of what they can do to you in your life because some people only want to know what you can do for them. And there comes a time where you just got to stop and say, listen, you need to go find another friend. Well, you're mean. I said, well, you're ugly. Come on. I have people come up sometimes and they say, well, you're turning gray. They're bald. I said, you're turning loose. One time my spiritual mentor had a guy come up to him and said, come on, he said, you're getting fat. And he said, well, you're ugly, but I can lose weight. Let me tell you what's worse is when somebody throws a rock at you and they miss, and that person picks up the same rock they tried to hurt you with, you turn around and throw it and hit them right in the forehead with it. They're thinking, my God, that's the rock I threw at you. That's what we should do with the devil. Come on now.
Yeah.
The devil comes up and says, you're not going to make it. I like picking his own rocks up and throwing them back at him.
Yeah.
You know what one of his rocks is? Doubt.
Yeah.
The devil says, you're not going to make it. You're not going to finish your course. You'll never get back on track. I said, I doubt that. Anytime the devil says anything to it, I go, I doubt it.
Yep.
Boom, hit him right in the forehead with his own word.
Yeah, that's right.
Come on now.
Yes.
James chapter 1, verse 1 through 8. I want to get through a lot of this tonight. James, the servant of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes that are scattered abroad, greetings. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. Knowing this, when are you supposed to count it all joy?
All the time.
When you fall into divers temptations, not when things are good. When things are bad, you should rejoice. Come on. Yeah. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have a perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Now let's get down to verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God to give it to all men liberally, and upbraid not, will be given him. Now watch this principle. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed, for let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable of all his what?
Ways.
Now that's in verse 8. But what that means is he'll be uncertain or unreliable about everything he thinks, feels, and decides. You'll never stay on course if you're double-minded. You'll never stay on course if you don't learn to count things all joy. If you don't rejoice in the hard times. If you come on now. There's a lot of attractions and distractions out there, folks. There are a lot of things going on. I said it this morning. Don't get your eyes so much up on the White House. Now, I know it's important that we have godly people, but judgment does not begin at the White House. It begins at the house of the Lord. Yeah. I mean, if God be for you, who could be against you? I mean, you're in this country, but you're not of this country. Come on. You still need to vote. You still need to obey the laws. Come on, you need to do a lot of things. But there comes a time in your life where you got to stand up and say, I got to get my priorities together. And the only way I can do that is recalculate to get back on course so I can finish my course. So God should strategically bring people into my life that I can meet their due seasons and their due times as well as they meet me. Because God is a master, how can I say it, strategist. He sees your, listen, let me say it this way. He knows your future better than you know your past. Amen?
Amen.
Now turn over to 2 Peter chapter 3, look at verse 1 through 4. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
This second epistle of love, and now writing you, which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that you might be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and in the commandments of the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Of the Lord and Savior, knowing this verse, that there shall come in the last days, what? Scoffers walking after their own lust. Now verse 3 says it this way in another translation. It says, to begin with, you must know and understand this, that scoffers and walkers are going to come in the last days, scoffing. People walk after their own fleshly desires, saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since for the forefathers fell asleep, all things have continued as they did from the beginning of creation. Now I've read this scripture here before, but this kind of goes right with what I'm preaching tonight. There's a lot of people who are going to be scoffing. They're going to be mocking. They're going to say, well, you know what? You're not tolerant enough. How are you sure what you believe is really true? See, I want to tell you something. The word compromise, if you really look at it, it says basically this. Compromise is accepting what you don't believe because you refuse to fight for what you do believe. Compromise is accepting what you don't believe because you've now refused to fight for what you do believe. Listen, you got to make a stand on something. If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything.
No.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Zero times one is same as zero times a million. I don't care how long you've been saved. You got to take a stand every day. You got to take up your cross.
Yes.
You got to follow Jesus.
Yes.
Well, times are different and politically correct. And, you know, maybe some of this stuff in the translations was lost. Guess what? You have just fell over and allowed them to become your teachers in Luke 6. Yeah. And it says, the blind will follow the blind, and when they fall into the pit or the ditch, they will fall both together. Amen?
Right.
Because if you listen to them long enough, you'll be fully trained just like your teacher.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot of people who say, oh, I believe in Jesus. Well, the devils believe in Jesus.
Yeah.
Sure. But do you have a personal relationship with him?
Yeah.
Do you know that your Redeemer lives?
Yes!
Come on, do you know your healer lives? Do you know there's a... Come on, there's a provider.
Thank you.
El Shaddai.
Yes.
The God that is more than enough.
Hallelujah.
People walk up and say, well, do you believe? I said, no. I know.
Yeah.
I can't answer for you, but I know.
Yeah.
There's been situations that didn't look like it was going to work. Or they said this, what do you think? It doesn't matter what I think. It's what God's word says. And I believe the report of the Lord.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I mean, this is still the day the Lord has made.
Yes.
We still rejoice and be glad in it. That's why he says, count it all joy. Be full of joy now. Why? Because joy is the very thing. And I preached it last year. Joy is the very thing that God uses to produce what you need, to add it to what you got. Where you're at, take it where you need to go.
Yeah.
How many knows it's through faith and patience? Do you know when you rejoice in the things of God, it produces steadfastness, endurance, and patience?
Yes.
And he adds that to your faith right in the middle of your pothole, the worst time of your life.
Yes.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord.
Your biggest debt, your biggest sickness, whatever it might be.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
He adds that to it. And he says, now stand on your feet and let your light shine before men.
Yes.
Because I'm not just bringing you out of the pothole. I'm bringing everybody else that's around you.
Yes.
And they're going to follow you out, bless God.
Yes.
People say, well, what if I stand up and do something and they run me out? I said, well, just get out in front, make it look like a parade. Amen. Amen. He's a good baby. No, we're kicking him out. Amen. Come on. Matthew chapter 22, look at verse 35 to 37. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked Jesus a question, tempting him, saying, Master, which is the great commandment of the law? Jesus said to him, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Now, when I see this on the heart, I know what that is. You believe with your heart, you confess with your mouth. That's how you got born again. The soul, and I've ministered this here many times, the soul consists of three parts. It's the mind which thinks. We say in America, it's the intellect. The mind which thinks, it's the intellect. The emotions which feel, come on, and the will which decides.
Right.
You remember when I used to be a maintenance man, I used to get up at 4:30, 5 in the morning, and my alarm would go off. And my mind will go. No, my body will go. I want to sleep another hour. And within 2 seconds, my mind will say, I think that's a great idea. Two-thirds of my soul right there. But what's the strongest part? The will.
Yes.
Jesus said, nevertheless, not what I think, not what I feel. He said, nevertheless, not what I choose.
Mm.
Not my will.
Yes.
But your will be done. See, Jesus learned to recalculate by acting on his will, because when you have to make a decision by acting your will cause your emotions to fall in line,
yes,
and eventually everything else will line up.
Yes. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
How many came here tonight without your bodies? You made a choice to come here. Guess what followed? You brought your body with your mind. Now, you might be daydreaming. You might be checking some scores out and checking your fantasy and pretending like you think you're getting by with it. You're looking up and going, amen, brother, praise the Lord. Oh, yeah. Watch everybody go over and look. You always can tell who's doing it. Their face is red. Let's see. One, two. Now watch. They just got all cool. I'm just picking on you. Just having fun. Now, here's the thing that threw me off. If you're going to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. But then all of a sudden he comes back and says, and with all your mind. I thought, wait a minute, why is he saying this again? Is he double compounding one third of the soul, which is the mind, which is the intellect? But I found out it wasn't. He was saying here in this last part of Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, he says, if you're going to love me, do it with the right attitude and behavior.
There you go.
You know, Isaiah 1:19 says, if you be willing, in obedience, you shall eat the good of the land. You know, obedience is an act of conduct. It's honorable, and you should be patted on the back that you bring your tithes. And I don't pay tithes anymore. I told my wife we stopped paying tithes a long time ago. I said, we're not putting it in the budget. I do all the bills. I'll pay the bills. You give the tithes and offerings. You see the difference? It's not in the budget. It's not something I pay. It's something I give.
Yeah.
Why? It's a form of worship.
Yeah.
And when I give it, it's holy unto God. And my wife writes it out. She did. Come on. Because I want her. She's a worshiper. She can sing.
Yes.
Boy, she can. She,
yes.
She gives, she'll give that tithes and offerings and stuff like this. But I pay the bills.
Okay.
Come on. Big difference. It's an attitude.
Yeah.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
But when you give offerings, do the same here. Now, the reason I say that is this. When you give that, you give it out of obedience. And that's good. But the word and is a conjunction. You can't have one without the other. I've shared this here before with you. You can have 4 jars of peanut butter, 3 loaves of bread. But if you have no jelly, do you know it's impossible for you to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich?
That's right.
But you can make a very impressive peanut butter sandwich. I meet people that are obedient. But if you really want to go to that next level where you stay on course to finish your course and enter into what the goodness of God is and get into that good and acceptable and perfect will of God and all that, you've got to add some jelly. You've got to be willing. And I found out willing is an act of submission of the heart. I don't have to do this. I get to do this. I don't have to come to church. I get to do that. Come on now. I don't have to do this. I get to do this. Come on now. People are actually fighting for the rights of what you will choose not to do in America. I'm not condemning you. She's thinking about it. You want to say it again? People overseas will fight for the rights to do what we already have the privilege of doing that we choose not to do. People want to give over there. There's a guy in Moscow that went over there, and all the people had because they were not taught prosperity. And they started, he said, you give what you got. He said, I don't care what it is. You give a tithe or something. And they would bring tithes of just stuff in, eggs or flowers or just whatever. He says, you bring something. Great, make sure it's a tithe. And bring an offering too. Do you know, after a few years of teaching people over there, that a minister went over there, a pretty well-known minister that I know. I mean, he travels and stuff. He had a big church at one time and different things turned over and stuff. But he said he got one of the biggest offerings from that group that he ever got, even in America. Why? In that short amount of time, they were willing, obedient and willing to just do with what they had where they're at.
Yeah.
Come on. Sometimes you just got to do what you can with what you've got where you're at. Did you hear what I said? Just do what you can with what you got right where you're at. You know, I was sitting in the office a while back. This is going to bless somebody. We'll get right back into this. I was sitting in the office one day, and, I get around different preachers and stuff. I mean, you know, Pastor John and Karen and your pastors over here. And, you know, you start hearing them on, you know, you sneak on YouTube, start hearing them or whatever. You think, oh, Lord. I thought I was a preacher. Man, they're really good. Then you get around some other preachers like, man, why should I even be in the ministry? But what I found myself doing was comparing myself with people.
Amen.
And I really started getting insecure about something.
Yeah.
I thought, Lord, you know, I'm doing everything I got, giving it, squeezing it, drying it out, squeezing it. I mean, doing everything I can to just give her, you know. You know, I was sitting in my office one day, and I believe the Lord said this to me word for word. Listen to this. It's going to bless some people. He said, I am not interested in your ability as much as your availability.
Yes.
You may not be the best at doing something, but that should never hold you back from giving your best to do.
There you go.
How many knows that you and I have been ordained unto good works, which He predestined that we should walk in them, living the good life, which He prearranged and made ready for us to live in Ephesians chapter 2.
Yep.
Right.
Come on, people say, well, I'm not supposed to do anything. Yes, you are. You've been ordained unto good works, which God predestined and planned beforehand, taking paths which He prepared ahead of time, that you should live a good life.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but when God's good life is not the same as your good life.
Right.
It's a lot better.
Amen.
It's where He blesses you and add no sorrow to it.
Right. Amen.
So you know what I found out? I know I'm not the best preacher you'll ever hear, but you hear better preachers every week. But the key is, if I'm going to give you my best when I show up. Come on, that's all I can do. I just give you my best, and you know what? I'm content with that. And I go on my way, and I try to be better and do better. I'm not trying to outdo anybody. Why? Because I'm not running their race. I'm running my race. And sometimes you've got to do it according to God's pace with His grace.
Yes.
As you seek His pace.
Amen.
Come on.
Yeah.
I got a friend of mine, I guess if I help some of the young kids. I got a friend of mine named Steve August. I ran into him in 1990-something, and I was working at Subway, and he was working in the athletic department at University of Tulsa. He was an All-American University of Tulsa in football. He got drafted number 13th in the first round pick in 1986, wow. I think it was. Played 9 years with Seattle, about a year or so with Pittsburgh, and then hurt his knee or something when he was going to go over to the Jets. And I asked her, I said, hey, brother? She goes, oh, yeah. I got two other brothers. She goes, did they make the NFL? He goes, no. He said, but they were more talented than I was. And I said, what happened? He said, they got distracted.
Exactly.
Oh,
wow. Yeah.
I said, what? He said, oh, they were more talented. He said, they should have made it before I did. I said, well, what was the difference? Because I was writing an article, and I needed something on him. And I was writing about the things about what is in a person. what's in the word potential? You know, everybody's got potential. You know, and there's different things inside that word potential. And I was looking them up, and I was finding it, and I went up and I put him in that article. Because I asked him, I said, well, Steve, what made you better than your brothers who were more talented than you? He said, I didn't get distracted. He said, I stayed with you. He said, I wasn't perfect. He said, but here's what I did. I did the basics every day. Every week. This is what he said. Week after week. He didn't say every day. He said, week after week, month after month, year after year. He said, first thing I know, I'm an All-American. Next thing I know, I'm a professional athlete in the United States football. He played 90 games with Seattle. He played right with Largent and all them guys. A big old guy, real nice and everything like that. But what I found out was he stayed with it and didn't allow other things to come in. Come on. Think about it now. Number 13 overall in the NFL draft. A lineman. Come on. Actually, he was in the trade that sent Dorsett to Dallas and he went to Seattle. You have no idea how your life affects history. Come on.
Come on, you're right.
How would Dallas Cowboys done without Tony Dorsett? And the only reason they traded Tony Dorsett is because my friend stayed the course as a lineman for all those years, stayed focused, worked on it. He said, I worked so much on the basics, I become a professional.
Yeah.
That's good.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's good.
1 Corinthians 6, 19, 20. What? Know you not your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, you have of God, you are not your own. Did y'all hear that? You don't even belong to yourself. If the Lord says, go to church, you say, I don't feel like it. He says, why, you don't belong to yourself. What gives you permission? I have people say, well, Lord, deliver me from all this. I can't handle this, all these temptations. The only way you're going to do that is die and go to heaven.
Yeah.
For absent with the bodies, being present with the Lord. It says, for you have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your bodies, in your spirits, which are of God. Now, let me cover a couple things here real quick, and I'm going to give you a few scriptures. We got still about 20 or 25 minutes, all right? Are y'all still going okay? Now, I want to show you the thing about Jesus. Jesus is probably he is the best example of somebody who stayed on course to finish the course. But what I want to do is, I want to bring in about two or three aspects of this, so I want you to listen to this. Because this is very important. When Jesus and the Father and the Son, how many knows the three are one? You got God the Father, God the Son, and Jesus the Holy Spirit. Even the Pharisees and the Sadducees came up and they said, our Father is Abraham. He said, well, before Abraham was I am. Now you're going to hear this again. But in Genesis chapter 1, it says, let us make man in our image and our likeness. Now image is essentially who you are. But the likeness is the reflection of the image that you were created in.
Yes. That's good.
That's why when you are an example or you witness or you're bearing fruit, then what happens is you are in the likeness of God because you're bearing an example of the image that you were created in.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're giving evidence to the proof of what you already are.
Right.
Come on.
Right.
An apple is a likeness of the apple tree because it came from it.
Right.
Come on now. I'm not going to get into that, but I'll get anyway. I want to make sure I teach you right. Amen. So here's what I'm going to say. An apple tree, let me just say it this way. Let's back up. I've never seen an apple tree say I'm an apple tree. It just bears fruit, and you eat it and tell the apple tree what it is.
Yeah, right.
So if you're creating the image of God, then you should have the witness of God in you, to where you're so much like God that they say, you know what? You're a Christ-like.
Yeah.
Yeah. We use the word today, Christian. You shall know them by their fruits. You know what fruits are? Especially in the book of John, it says in Vine's Dictionary, the Old and New Testament words, it says that they are visible expressions of power that work inwardly and invisibly of the character of the power producing you. In other words, the fruits are a result of what's really going on inside of you. See, that's why you can have let me just take a little note here before we go on. You can have the best ministers in the nation stand up here and preach. You got some of the best pastors. I'm not just saying it because I'm here. I travel a lot. And I'm not trying to put one person's light out to make another one's brighter. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying you got people that live the walk. I mean, they walk the walk and live the life.
Yes.
Come on now, they pray.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
But they can teach you and give you the most precious seed called the Word of God. But if you have contaminated soil or contaminated water, what do I mean? If that word goes into your heart and your soil of your heart is full of bitterness and unforgiveness and doctrines of religions and stuff, and all that comes out of your mouth is but contaminated water, say, well, I don't know why it doesn't work for me. You know, I mean, I don't need to always complaining and being critical. I don't care. This seed will eventually become contaminated based upon what it was put in. Not because of where it came from, but where it went into.
Ooh, that's so good.
Wow.
His word will not return to him void if you do it right.
Thank you, Lord.
So you can receive a revelation of it. Come on. Now, I'm not saying you're watering down the word, but in your life, you end up developing a form of godliness, but you end up denying the power thereof, because if you don't obey what he says, then you're actually denying the power that's actually trying to set you free by leaning on what you think and what you believe.
Yes. Come on. Yes.
That's good. Amen.
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 Yeah. So you can't rely on what you think or what you believe. You got to be willing and obedient to just come to the Father and say, Father, I know I was created on the sixth day.
Right. Amen.
Because you're part of mankind. I don't care who you are or where you came from or what your culture is or what side of the ocean you were born on or what your skin or hair or whatever. I don't care about all that. Everybody alive today can trace your bloodline back to Noah, Noah back to Adam, and Adam came from the dirt. Everybody is part of the same family.
Amen.
Come on.
Yes.
So what happens is we get into the Word of God, and then we contaminate it through our thinking and our believing and our speaking, and then we say, well, the Word doesn't work. I've tried it for 3 years. No, it hasn't. You've been trying to change the word to fit your lifestyle that you want to adjust. The way you talk, the way you think, the way you believe, the way you speak. If you don't, the word becomes non effect, and you actually end up bearing artificial fruit in your life because you have a form of godliness.
Oh, that's so true.
You will win more people to the Lord by just living a life of holiness according. You know what holiness is? Yeah. Is when you do what God says to do, yep, and you say what God says to say.
Yes.
If you do that, the Word becomes holy in your life.
Yes.
And when you walk according to the Word, you're literally walking in the Spirit.
Yes.
So you won't fulfill the lust,
yes,
of the flesh.
Yes. 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 That's holiness. You're right.
Peter was so full of the thing like a sponge, even his shadow. Go back to Genesis 1. Jesus was the best example of somebody who stayed on course,
yeah,
to finish his course.
Yeah.
Genesis 1, let us make man in our image and likeness. Is that singular or plural? Plural means more than one.
Yeah.
I mean, it's plural. Let us, right?
Right.
So when Adam came, they breathed something inside of him. What did they breathe? People said, well, oxygen. Well, maybe they did. But I do know that they breathe the substance in him called spirit. Everybody has that substance in them because it was passed down one to another. And we all trace our bloodline back to Adam. That's why when Adam sinned, what happened in the garden? Why did Adam sin? Well, actually, Adam is the one that was at fault, not Eve, because Eve was deceived. Adam did it with his eyes wide open by an act of his will. And from that moment on, a poison bloodline was developed, and everybody in that was born from that first Adam under that poison bloodline. But then a young virgin Jewish girl named Mary, people said, well, how do you know it was Mary? Well, the Bible tells me that. She might have been the third or fourth one that the angel went to, but she was the first to agree. I know that.
Yeah.
A lot of people think Abraham might have been the first, third or fourth one. I don't know. Think about it. God is not going to make you do anything. So she came up, so how is this possible knowing I've never been with a man? The angel, which is the messenger of God, not speaking on himself, only for whom he represents. He said, I have not come to do my thing. Listen, you know you and I are ambassadors for Christ. An ambassador is any authorized messenger or representative. In other words, they only do and say who by whom they represent. We send them all around the world. When I flew into Athens, we drove by and they said, just in case you need to know, that's the United States Embassy right there. I said, thank you. Why? Because I have a passport that gives me right way into that as a citizen of the United States. I'm not from Athens. I'm not from Greece. I might be in Greece, but I'm not of Greece, but I'm allowed in there.
Yes.
Ooh, that's good.
Because that is an isolated area that gives me the rightful privilege and security as an American citizen or whatever nationality to go in there and have what I need done. Why? Because I have a thing called the Bill of Rights. How many knows you and I are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus?
Thank you, Lord.
We have certain rights with God.
Yes, we do.
Come on, the devil will come to you and try to do all this, bring you under condemnation, get you under this guilt, shame, hurt, pain, bitterness, get all these different ways he's trying to do. Trying to get you back off course.
Right.
Now watch this. So what happened is, when she said, "Be it unto me according to your word," she wasn't just saying to the angel, she was saying to whom the angel represents.
Yes.
When she said, "Be it unto me according to your word," and Holy Spirit came upon her, and she was pregnant with the seed of God.
Yes.
Yeah. That was the only person that was not born under the bloodline of the first Adam.
Right.
And we know in John chapter 1, it says in verse 13 and 14, it says, "And the Word came and dwelt among us, and we beheld the glory of the only begotten, full of grace and truth." Why? It says, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
Yes.
And you know what Jesus did in his earthly ministry? When he walked among us, you know what he did? If you notice it, even at, I think it's Luke 2:47, when they finally found him at age 12, what did he say? "I must be about my Father's business." Now listen, he was coming to fulfill what the first Adam messed up. How did he do that? Well, he was sitting in heaven one day at the right hand of the throne of God. And he chose an agreement with the Father because he said, "My Father and I are one." He took off the robe of the Son of God and laid it down and came to earth and humbled himself. Can you put up Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 8 in the Amplified, please? Philippians 2, 5 through 8 in the Amplified. He humbled himself, came down, and was born in a manger. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? As an infant. And people say, "Well, what's significant about that?" Well, because he was 100% God, but he was also 100% man. The Bible says he was afflicted with all the afflictions as we were. He was tempted in all manner of man and women, but without sinning. The biggest difference a lot of people don't understand is this. Jesus never committed a sin. He was made to be sin. When you get born again, you do not get righteousness. You become the righteousness of God. It's what you are born into. Listen, people say, "Well, I understand." When you were born a male, people say, "Well, how was you born a male?" "I was just born this way." "Well, what makes you the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus?" "Well, I was just born again this way." He took my guilt and shame and gave me his confidence and love. He was made poor that I might be rich.
Hallelujah.
Come on, he went to hell so I could go to heaven.
Hallelujah.
Come on, by his stripes, I am healed.
Yeah.
He was such a perfect substitute when he was hanging between heaven and earth. Now, don't leave here without misquote me. I don't want you to do that. Listen. He was such a perfect substitute in the eyes of God that when he hung between heaven and earth, and he took upon him all the afflictions and all the different things. Listen, he had to die to it so you wouldn't have to live with it. He had to feel the emotional breakdown, the depression, the bipolar. Come on, he had to have that. Come on, all the temptations of suicide. He had to feel the loneliness and despair and those dark places of depression. He had to have it all on there. Why? So he could be your perfect substitute. He was such a perfect substitute being 100% man and 100% God that in the eyes of God it was as if. Somebody say, as if.
As if.
It was as if you and I were on the cross. Don't leave here and say that. The preacher said we had to go to the cross, and I didn't say it. I said Jesus was such a perfect substitute. It was as if you and I were on the cross.
Yeah.
So when the devil comes to you and says, "Yeah, you know what? I put cancer on you because I want to kill you with it. I put that liver disease on you because I'm going to kill you with it. I'm going to put that..." Come on.
Nope.
You said, "It's in your bloodline." I said, "Well, first of all, April 28, 1974, I got born again."
Yes.
I went from one bloodline into another bloodline.
Yeah.
And besides that, if Jesus died to it on the cross as my perfect substitute, I'm identified in him, and it's where I live. I'm in with him. And John 15:5 says, "If I abide in him and his words abide in me, we are the same." And the Bible says in Corinthians, who is joined with God is one spirit. So therefore, when Jesus died of that cancer and hemochromatosis, Todd Bailey died to it too. Therefore, you can't kill me with it again. You can't kill somebody twice with the same thing. Jesus showed up on the scene. Why did he show up on the scene? What was so important for him to come? Because he had to be 100% man as well as 100% God. Look what he did. He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. This is so important. Who being in the form of God, he did not consider himself robbery to be equal with God. Watch it. But he made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and becoming the likeness of men. One translation says, he became a human being. Look at verse 7. But made himself of no reputation. Now, let's go on to the next one. Verse 8. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of the death, even the death of the cross. You know what the Amplified says? I got to read it. I appreciate y'all putting it up there, but I like my Amplified. Amen? He was, well, you like the Amplified? Well, it's just louder. Amen? Well, I never talked about that. Listen to this. Are y'all doing okay tonight?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Let this same attitude and purpose of mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Let him be your example of humility, who, although being essentially one with God in the form of God, possessing all the fullness of the attributes which make God God, he did not think himself equal with God as a thing to be equally grasped and retained, but he stripped himself of all the privileges and rightful dignity as to assume the guise of a servant slave and become like the men. It was born a human being. And after he appeared in human form, he abased and humbled himself still further and carried his obedience to the extreme death, even the death of the cross. Why did he do this? He came to set an example for you and I to follow him. But if you read in the scriptures in Romans chapter 5, I think it's verse, I forgot what it is now. It's, I think it's 15 through 20. If you read that, and you also read 1 Corinthians 15, verse 45 through 48, it talks about two Adams. One came from the earth, earthly, the second one came from heaven above. One was earthly, one was spiritual. One disobeyed God in one garden, and many become unrighteous, or many were sinners. But in the second garden, the one that came from heaven, that was spiritual, he obeyed God in that garden, and many become righteous. And many become believers. Are you hearing what I'm saying? There was two Adams and two gardens. I'm not living under the old garden anymore. I'm not living under the old Adam anymore. Amen. Come on now. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Behold, all things have passed away.
Yes.
Things have become new now.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Jesus walked among us and everything. Turn to Exodus chapter 3. I'm going to show you what he did here. He came to fulfill what the first Adam did, but he also established a better covenant on better promises. Come on, he didn't do away with the old covenant. He fulfilled it.
Yes.
Look at the Amplified Version, verse 13, 14, and 15. And Moses said to God, behold, when I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am and what I am, and I will be what I will be. And he said, you shall say this to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. And God also said to Moses, this shall you say to the Israelites, the Lord God of your fathers, of Abraham, Isaac, and of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name. Watch this. This is my name. This is my name. For what?
Forever.
And by this name I am to be what? Remembered by all generations.
Yeah.
So when they walked up to Jesus and he showed up on the scene, it was not just Mary's son walking around. They said, who are you? He didn't say, well, I used to live down three streets over here and my mother was Mary and all this. No, he came up and they said, well, who are you? He said, well, I will tell you this. I only come and do what I see the Father do. I only come and say what I hear the Father say.
Yeah.
I've not come to do my will, but I've come to do His will. But who are you? And every time they asked him, he always would pre-reference it with these two words that point it right back to the Father. He said, I am the door. I am the light. I am he who was dead, but now alive. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes unto me. Because if you see me, you've seen the Father. You want me to tell you why? Because I'm right on the will of God. I'm right in the course. And when I hit the landing strip, I'm hitting it right in the middle. Because I've got an expectation. And the way I'm going to endure the cross is because of the joy that was set before me.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, yeah.
Come on now.
Amen.
I remember one time he was in Columbus, Ohio, and how many knows it's important not to guess at landing strips? Folks, I'm 2 out of 10 on the last. I think I got a good feeling about this. I'm not getting on the plane. No good feeling.
No.
I'm going to end up in a hayfield. We had a pilot that was coming into Columbus, Ohio, and I remember this. It was so foggy that when all of a sudden the runway just appeared. It just appeared all of a sudden. Not disappeared, it appeared. And he went, boom, took right back off, went around. We got around a little bit. Well, he goes, ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to startle anybody. He said, I just was not comfortable with my approach and the position of where I was going to land on the runway. So I'm just going to go around and make sure that we're going to hit right where we're supposed to.
Yeah.
How many knows I'm loud? I said, you take as many times as you want to. How many knows it's better to be 10 minutes late than dead?
Yeah.
There's better ways getting on the news instead of that. Amen?
Yeah.
Come on now. Yeah. They asked me the other day, are you able and willing to sit in the emergency row exit and help the bed? I said, yeah, if they can follow my way. I'm almost saying, wide rear end off this thing. I'll go right off, and they can follow me. Come on, I'll look at this way. I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry. What do you want me to say? Well, thank you for flying Delta. Sorry, this never usually happens when we land over here in this field. I'm not going to sit there. I'm going to open the door and say, hey,
let's go.
This way. Move them up. Play Rawhide or something. Get them going. Amen.
Right.
Listen, I'm going to tell you something. Jesus, when he took off the robe of the Son of God, he became the Son of Man. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Do you know when Jesus died on the cross, do you know what his last word was? Now listen, I know he rose again. He walked among the brethren. There's other things he did. And then he went back to the Father. But what's the last word that Jesus said on the cross before he went? No. I said the last word.
Finished.
He said, it is
finished.
That's the last word he said.
Yeah.
Around Easter, I looked that up. I thought, what's the last word Jesus said before he went to hell and died for us and was hung on the cross? I looked it up. Finished. So I looked up that word, and it says everything that basically Jesus did for all humanity and mankind can be wrapped up and summed up in that one word.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I want Jesus to just say, you know, you finished. Come on.
Yes.
Listen, I was not a good runner when it came to running distant races. I just did it for the shirt. I just did it to see if I could do it. Amen. I didn't know how to train. I would run starting out, those 10,000 meter runs. All of a sudden, I just start running real fast. People are like, we got 5.5 miles. You're way kicking. I said, there's a refreshment stand up here. It's free. Did I slow down? I did. Honestly, I go, throw it off to the side, and I ran a little bit more. Then I see another one, and I run again. I didn't care what people thought. You want me to tell you why? They were spectators. I mean, and I was a participator. And you know the difference between participators and spectators? We get ours free. Because we're in the race. God will refresh you in the time. Come on now. God says, I don't care how you finish. Just make sure you finish your course with joy. Come on, finish your race.
Yeah.
I know I couldn't beat none of those guys. It was way out in front of me already. But you know what? I finished it.
Yeah.
Man, I felt good too. I got my shirt. Come on. I didn't care if people laughed at me. They didn't get a shirt if they didn't have nobody. There's a big difference between spectators and participators.
Yeah,
amen.
Yeah.
You know, the scripture says Jesus is the author and the finisher of our what?
Faith.
Of our faith.
Yeah.
You know, I looked this up and this really surprised me. I thought, I've heard that all my life. What does that really mean? It says the same race that you're running that Jesus also started and that you started, he has already finished it and will come back and help you finish it.
Amen.
That's why he already knows where the still waters and the green pastures are.
Yeah.
He said, just follow me. I'll show you where they're at. Come on. I know you don't ask for directions when you go to the mall, but if you just let me show you, I'll come on.
Yeah.
Now, let me show you about the life of Paul real quick, and we'll finish up here. Praise the Lord. How many eat leftovers today? Praise the Lord. I'll stay home and make a morning sermon. I ain't going out anymore on Sunday. Praise the Lord. How many knows? Now, I'm going to say something now. A lot of people get this wrong, so think before you answer. There's a scripture that says, Paul said, I press towards the
mark.
I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling. He said, I press towards the mark for the prize. You know what I tell you why Paul pressed towards mark? Because the prize was so far away, it was unreachable. There was no way that I could have walked over here. I could have done it from where I live. But you know, when I went to the airport shuttle, what I do is I back out of my driveway, turn left, go south to Caribou, about 100 feet, make a left, go out and hit Timberline, go south about a half a mile, and then hit Harmony, and then go east about 2.5 miles, then make a left into the Harmony Transport Center, get on a shuttle, drive 64 miles, and drop me off at door 510 on the west side. It's a red door with a circle around it. Then I go in and get my stuff, and then I either go through A Terminal or go through the Bay One, get on my plane and fly here. That's just my routine. Amen? But there was no way that I could see the airport. So if I would have walked out of my driveway and said, I don't see it, I'm going to go back to the house.
Come on.
Yeah.
No, I have to connect some dots first.
Yeah.
Go on. And you know how many knows when I got on that plane, it flew all the way to Los Angeles. That was a long distance between two dots.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. I'm glad I sat on the plane. Then I had to go to the different terminals. LAX. My Lord, that was like that little thing where you connect all the dots in. Why is this necessary? For the outcome of the picture.
Yes.
Got on another plane, flew over here, and amen. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
Come on. How many knows that this church is a long distance from where I live in Colorado? It's just like your walk with Christ. Most of us should live to be in our 80s, early 90s. You say, oh, not me, oh, my grandparents' parents. See, you're thinking totally different now. You know what I've said for 15 to 20 years? People say, well, if it doesn't happen, I said, well, I'd rather aim for the moon and hit the top of the trees and aim at nothing, hit it every time.
Yeah.
I keep saying that.
Yeah.
They say, well, what about 120? Not me. Not me. Because if I have to take something to make me go to the bathroom and I can't get there in time to go to the bathroom, I'm out of here, amen. I'm just being honest with you. Come on. I mean, who wants to sit here and live and say, I only got 16 more years to prove everybody I had faith to live to be 120? How long have you been wearing Depends? 10? Now, I'm not being... Come on, are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You tell me a great man or a woman of God, besides George Beverly Lachey, that lived to be past 100 years old.
Right.
Most of the great men and women of God, it probably reminds her of a shoe store or something. Most of them didn't even live to be past 90.
Yeah, right.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Right.
Let's just say 90 years old. Yeah. Think about how old you are right now and say, boy, that's a long way away. A lot of people don't even run the race while it's so far away. You know, Pastor John and Karen, when they get in the car and drive to Missouri or wherever they go, how many knows it takes a while to get there? But how many knows if, as long as they draw nigh to Missouri, Missouri draws nigh to them.
Yeah, that's right.
So I ran across this real quick. Paul had there's a timetable here. I found a Paul of life. This is great. There's 500 and some things here of Paul's event. No, 300. 300 and some events of Paul's life. Tells you how old he was, where he was born, what year it was born, how old he was at one year, what happened, when he wrote this book, where he was, when he got in prison, what should be. All these things. It's great. Then I found out that these were actually not events. These are marks. Almost like it connected them. Some of them are real bunched together, the years. I mean, there's a ton of them that happened right. And you think, man, there's some that didn't happen for a little while. And think, oh, man, he was in prison for how long during that time? Oh, but he wrote what?
Yeah.
I found out delayed is, just because you're delayed, it doesn't mean you're denied.
Yes!
Come on.
That's good.
You know, you can make more progress sometimes with just being quiet.
Yeah,
and sitting down and waiting until the Lord speaks to you and recalculate.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Well, it's not working. Let's just get out and drive. Oh, yeah, now you're going to get really lost.
Right, yeah.
Now, watch this. I found out these are marks, and I need to hurry. These are marks in Paul's life. Do you know if Paul was not obedient in this mark? I just randomly picked it. Let's see what it is. This is when he was at Iconia in Acts chapter 13. Right before that, it was the ministry in Antioch. And from there, it was from Paphos that went to Perga, and he went where John Mark departed for home. And before that, it was while they were on Cyprus, they went to Solomon, and it just went on back. And this is where Barnabas and Saul were separated, Acts chapter 13. Are you seeing how all this? Now, how many knows if Paul was not faithful? Come on.
Come on.
In that one, he would have never
reached
that one.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Do you know if he wasn't faithful up here, he'd never reach these down here? Why? Because it's important for you to hit the number right after the other number and connect the dots. Some of them were so little on all this. Why? But Paul realized it's important for the final outcome of the picture. Do you know one of the ones that really stand out to me when I was reading it? It said that at age 29, Paul had a road to Damascus experience. You remember that?
Yes.
Paul, why do you persecute me? He said, well, who are you? He said, I'm Jesus. And he had a road to Damascus experience. You know, Jesus ministered to him. He said, you're going to suffer great things for my name's sake, and you're going to stand before what?
Kings.
You know, there was one time that Paul was in different situations, and he got up there. Now, watch this. And I believe Paul, at times, his mind began to wander. Even though he's trying to recalculate, but when you're sitting in a prison cell, sometimes they were so short, he had to lay down and stretch out. Come on, think about it. Open sewer, pit, area, in a prison. I mean, you're riding by candlelight next to a sewer pit. You're going to find out how dedicated you are. Amen? Come on now. But he knew there was a landing strip down at the end of his life. He knew he had it connected right now. There's times he saw it and said, Lord, I've sought you 3 times. Things are just buffing me so much. He said, my grace is sufficient. So he recalculated. He recalculated. He recalculated. Do you know there was one time Paul, I believe, got to the place where, now he's 54 years old. This is 25 years later. Paul's an older man now. They summons him out. They bring him in stocks with about 300 people, I mean soldiers around him. 250 to 350, they said was the average. So I just rounded off to 300. They bring him up. Now he's 54 years old. It's about 6 years before he gets killed or martyred or whatever. He stands there, looks up, and guess who's in front of him in Acts chapter 26? King Agrippa. Now, if you read in verse 1 and 2, it's really interesting because he says, Paul, you're permitted to speak, and he went on through that. And after verse 2, if you read all the way down, it finds out that they have a really good conversation, and we hear those famous phrases, Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. But what got my attention was this older man, 25 years later, coming up, trying to hit the last marks of his life so he could finish his course. He gets up, he sees King Agrippa, and before he says anything in verse 1 and 2, he says this. Now, let me please paraphrase this. I'm going to take it out of context. But he just basically said, okay, I'm going to say something. Nobody else is going to understand, but maybe me and God. That's it. But today, I make myself happy. You know why? He hit one. There it was, prophesied 25 years before. Boom, there he is. Amen? Now some of you have been staying on course, recalculating, keeping your hands to the plow, almost becoming growing weary and well-doing, but you said, no, I'm going to not get entangled into things in the flesh. I'm going to renew my mind. I'm going to set, come on, I'm going to make sure I'm staying on course to finish my course because it's not about me. I'm about letting God strategically use my life to come into other people's life and do seasons and do times. And when I get, and all of a sudden, you think, man, God, it's been a long time since I've got a confirmation. I had a word that I've been standing on for 8 years right now. That everybody's forgotten about but me. And all of a sudden something will happen. You go, whoa! I am right on course. Boy, I just hit a mark.
Amen.
And you just want to pause. Everybody goes, what's going on? I said, you're not going to understand this, but maybe me and God. But right now,
right.
I think myself happy.
That's good. That's true. Amen.
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 That's
Let's finish this up real quick. For all you participants tonight, you will receive a coupon for a free cruise. No, I'm just saying. I woke up the rest of it. Let me just say this. Do you ever notice servants never tell the king where they're going to serve in the kingdom?
Yeah.
That's good.
If you want to be a, that's why I asked him one day, I said, how do you be a leader? I said, learn to serve. If you want authority, look for responsibility.
Yeah.
Don't look for the title. Don't look for this and that. Amen? I prophesied, and I believe it's going to happen to Monica pretty soon. I mean, I'm not saying what, I let God do what God wants to do. There is a pastor's daughter, and I know her husband, they're in the ministry in Collinsville, Oklahoma. I've been preaching for about 3 weeks, but I ministered to her. I said, you've been in the back for so long,
yeah,
and you've been so faithful in the back, that God's about ready to show your faithfulness in front of everybody. I didn't even know this. They brought her up front right after that. I didn't even know it was all planned. She's the main person now that you go through in the office. She stands up and sets the service in line. Gives the announcements. Make sure everything. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Come on. Now, I'm not just saying that she's going to be up in front, but I'm going to tell you something. When God promotes you, come on now. Think about it. God could give her one idea about children's ministry. She could write a book, bring in $1 million. Michael should have done that. Amen. She must owe you money. No, I'm just kidding. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Quit limiting God. Yeah. If you're faithful little, you'll be faithful over much. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He may exalt you in due season.
Amen.
The way up in the kingdom is down.
Yeah.
He humbled himself still yet further, and God still yet raised him up,
yeah,
because he went back to the Father. Jesus said, now in my name you go and do these things. Because he said, I'm taking off the robe of the Son of Man, and in my name I'm giving you authority, because I'm going back and sitting at the right hand of the throne, and I'm going to put on the robe of the Son of God, and I'm going to sit there and make intercession for you day and night. And besides that, I'm going to send you a comforter, a teacher, a guide, an intercessor, a standby, and he's going to teach you and guide you into all truth. And we call it the Holy Ghost, and you're going to have no excuse not to finish our call.
Hallelujah!
Oh, man, he misses the Holy Ghost. Let me finish with two verses here. We all know 9:23 and 24 in Luke. Luke 9:23 and 24 says this. And he said to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself. Take up his cross daily and follow me. Now, I understood that part. Okay, take up your cross daily and follow me. Whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my name's sake is the one who will save it. Now, I read that, but I kept going, what does this really mean? Then I came across a verse in Matthew chapter 10 that really helped me. You know what it is? Verse 38 and 39 says this. If you don't go all the way with me through thick and thin, you don't deserve me.
Yeah.
If your first concern is to look after yourself, you'll never find yourself. But if you forget about yourself and look to me, you'll find both yourself and me.
Praise God.
I don't know about you, but that's worth it.
Thank
come on.
Jesus.
Yeah.
That's worth jumping around about.
Amen.
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 Yes.
Can't cast away your confidence. Has a great recompense and reward. If you don't go all the way with me through thick and thin, you don't deserve me. If your first concern is to look after yourself, you never find yourself. But if you forget about yourself and look to me, you'll find both yourself and me. Let me say this in closing. I believe one day you're going to look up. You're just going to know it. I just went from 99 to 100. I just connected to 100 dots.
Yes.
Boy, I messed up a lot in my life, but thank God that his eraser of forgiveness got me back on course.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
You know what mercy and goodness is? We always quote it. Mercy and goodness follows us all the days of our lives. Goodness forgives you of what you don't deserve. Mercy forgives you of what you do deserve.
Yes.
And it follows you all the days of your life. I found out the person that the most people cannot forgive in their life, you know who it is?
Themselves.
And I'm going to be honest with you, you've got to get to the place where you get over yourself, forgive yourself, and then look to others.
Yeah.
Because I'm telling you, this thing's bigger than you and I.
Yep.
God's going to call the ripple effect in your life. He wants something to happen in your life that affects everybody around you.
Yes, sir.
Folks, all I'm waiting to hear if Jesus comes back before I hit 90, but one day I won't hit 100. By the grace of God, I'm going to 100.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
The only reason I'm doing it is this. Is I want to hear. There's just certain words I want to hear.
Yeah.
Well done.
Yeah.
Thou good and faithful servant.
Yeah.
That's all I'm waiting to hear.
Thank you, God.
Well done. Forget about the rest. I mean, I'm honored. I'm not brushing that off. I don't need to be called a reverend or a prophet or a teacher. No. I just want to be somebody who loved God and followed after.
Yes.
And reach people with the love of God. And one day when I stand before Him, I don't care how He says it, you did good. You did good. Think about it. Think when your dad or your grandpa walked by and says, you did good.
Yeah.
It didn't matter what the newspaper said. It didn't matter if the team kicked you off the place.
Yeah.
The person that was most important in your life. That's all that matters.
Yeah.
When your ways please God, He'll even make your enemies to be at peace with you. Amen?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Did y'all get anything out of this tonight?
Thank you,
Lord. Lord, I thank you and I pray for you. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, we commit our way. You know, the Lord spoke to me one day and said, why am I obligated to meet needs that people have not committed to obey me yet? He said, if you don't commit yourself or obey what I've called you to do and commit yourself to it, then why am I obligated to meet a need that does not exist? We want God to meet our needs before they even exist. Because we won't commit our way. But I'm telling you, the moment you step out of faith, all of a sudden needs show up.
Yeah.
And God says, now I have something to meet.
Yes.
If you really love God, it's not your desires that He gives you. Watch this. You said, Lord, I want you to give me desires of my heart. You said, you give me desires of my heart. No, if you really love God with all your heart, He's the one that gives you the desires of your heart. You see the difference?
Yeah.
Why? He knows what you really need right when you need it.
Come on, that's right.
When He blesses you, He adds no sorrow, regret, shame, hurt, condemnation, or anything else to it. Amen? Amen?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Does anybody need prayer tonight? How many's born again? Just raise your hand. I do altar calls backwards. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Everybody over here saved? Are you saved? Praise the Lord. This guy's my God. Amen. Everybody, are you saved? Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
If you're not saved by YouTube, Romans 10:9, 10:10, believe in your heart, confess with your mouth. All you have to do is cry on the name of the Lord and you shall be saved.
Amen.
There's no name under heaven that men shall be saved by except Jesus.
That's right.
Isn't that amazing?
It is.
All you can do is say Jesus.
Jesus.
You know when you say Jesus, you know what actually happens? You actually are running into a strong tower. The Bible says the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and save it.
Jesus.
Yes. Think about that.
Yes.
Jesus.
Jesus.
I had people come up and say, I don't know how to pray. I said, here's what I want you to say for the next 3 minutes. Jesus. They said, what? I said, the best way to pray, just say Jesus. I said, He'll show up.
Oh yeah.
And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit will show up.
Come on.
How many knows if you light a light bulb outside, there's going to be stuff that shows up.
Oh yeah.
You do it in the Spirit, good things show up.
Oh,
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Yeah. Just turn everything off your iPhone. Don't even put on vibrate. Don't even see it where the light's up. Put it all in the other room. Just sit there and say, Jesus. Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. I thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on. You look at some people keep looking at their watch. It's only been 2 minutes. It's only been 2 minutes. You get your mind off your watch. You get your mind on the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Look down, it might be 35 minutes. You say, well, what happened? Well, He just did some things that you didn't have to be involved in.
Hallelujah.
But you've been in the way so much. You just finally yielded to Him and let Him come in and interrupt your life. Amen? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. I love coming here. I just leave sharpened, refreshed, revived. Amen? There's times I come not feeling well, leave with my healing. Amen? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. I had people come up to me and say, oh, you're preaching those faith churches. I said, well, compared to what, one of those doubt and unbelief churches? I mean, people ask the dumbest questions. Well, what if I don't get saved and accept Jesus when I die? So you go to hell. Well, what if I don't believe in hell? Oh, you will. About 2 seconds, you'll rise. I don't care what translation you think the Bible is. Amen. Does anybody need prayer for anything tonight? Father, I thank you. I praise you, Jesus. I want to step out and say this. I don't know if somebody knees pop a lot or it slides. You have a loose knee. And there's times when you walk, it pops. But it's almost like I don't know if it's the kneecap or there's something that slides or shifts in your knee. Because you can be sitting there and walk perfect and all of a sudden you'll turn a certain way. And you can feel that thing move without your leg moving. Because it just gave. Who is that? Is that you? Come on up here. Are you the only one that didn't raise your hand? Come on over here. Man, I just come to Sunday night with my friends. And the preacher calls me out. And my friends rat me out. Go ahead and sit down. We'll pray for you. What's your name? Hunter. What grade are you in? 10. Wow. I wish I was that big enough. I was 5'2 as a freshman in high school. 5'6 as a junior. Wow. Yeah. Got to cut off the girls' volleyball team, amen? Thank you, Lord. I just believe we're not just going to pray for your knee. I believe there's some other words. Father, in the name of Jesus. Does anybody else need prayer for anything? Praise the Lord. Who's hurt your ankle? Either twisted it real bad, had surgery or something. And here's the best way I can say it. It just feels thick. It's never really felt like the other ankle. It's never really felt thin. It swells up from time to time, especially if you sit on long trips and don't get out. But it just feels thick. When you bend it doesn't bend like the other one. It feels, or y'all understand what I'm saying? It just like, it feels like it's thick all the time. It's not the same. Who is that? Father, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on over here. Praise the Lord. Go up there and sit in the front. We're going to pray for you too. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Can I ask you something? It doesn't have to be personal. If it's personal, you tell me. But is there something else with your knee besides that just really you want God to touch in your body? Is it a shoulder or is it a rib or, I mean, I don't know. I just feel like there's something else we need to pray for. Maybe I just need to pray and just ask God to go ahead and do it. Amen?
Amen.
Is that okay? You believe in healing?
Thank
you. Yes or no? All right. The reason I do that is you got to say something. Amen. The word's voice activated.
Yeah.
I had a little girl in Wyoming. I said, you don't have what you nod, you have what you say.
Yeah.
Is it the ankle, the knee right there? Put your hand on it. Now, what did you do to hurt that?
Too active.
Too active? I mean, you weren't jumping off ropes or anything, right? That's how bored we were growing up. We had nothing. You just jump off ropes. Just see who else can. That's a big one. I bet you I can jump off it. I bet you I can do it. All right. You go find a way to get on the road and jump off. I used to be 6'5". No, I'm just not. You ready? Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for Hunter. I thank you for his life. I thank you most of all, Father, you're going to show your goodness to him and heal his knee right now. We'll keep the knee from sliding, going back and forth. Father, whatever needs to take place. If you need to give Hunter a new knee, so be it. Father, we're just asking you right now, according to Mark 16:18, as you lay hands upon him, we command his knee to be made whole, Father. Either through reconstruction or creation or just maintenance, Father. But Father, I believe also in the name of Jesus, there's some other things, I don't know what they are, but I just feel prompted that by the Spirit of God, that you're taking care of these things, you're tweaking them, Father, yes. And there's not going to be any flare-ups or any little things here and there comes up to where it's, well, it's not nothing major, it only comes and goes every so often. No. Jesus paid it in full, should we live in the fullness of what he paid for. So I loose the healing power of God upon them, and I apply the blood of Jesus around him and his friends. And Father, let them be an influence in their school. And I ask you right now, as they rise up, you give them the boldness to say no when they need to say no. And give them the boldness to say yes when they need to say yes, Father. I ask you to make them witnesses, not just a witness, but make them witnesses, Father, to where instead of telling people who they believe and who they serve, that people say, those kids over there, those classmates are Christians.
Yeah.
How? Well, we just know it in their lifestyle. They live it. They walk the walk. They live it. And if you mess up, don't beat yourself up. Just say, Father, you know what? I messed it. I missed the mark. So I'm backing up, recalculating. I'm getting back on course in Jesus' name. Be healed now. Praise the Lord. Worship Him. Praise the Lord. Come over here. I want to pray for you. Does anybody else want prayer tonight? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord in Jesus' name. Thank you. Lev, thank you. What did you do? Now, she says she jumped off the house. What happened? Okay. Now, here's what I want you to do. There's three things the Lord showed me during the situation of my healing. I thought about sharing it this morning, but I didn't get around to it. Number one was this. He says, your tongue controls your body.
Yeah.
You know the second thing he showed me during all this situation the last 2-3 years? He said, all of a sudden I seen a dog sitting on the street corner next to me. I was like waiting to catch a bus or standing there. And I see myself praying this. Lord, I know you hear me when I pray. I know this dog's not going to come down my door. Lord, I thank you to this dog. You're going to shut the mouth of the... I mean, I just started praying this prayer about the dog.
Yeah.
And the Lord said, that's good, but there's times in your life you have to do this. And he took me to the scripture, and when I read it, he says, and you shall say unto...
Yeah.
That's all I see. Unto... You shall say unto. He said, I want you to turn around and command the dog. He says, there's times you have to speak to that situation directly over and over. The third thing is the thing that I really think I'm going to start ministering on a little bit. I was sitting there about ready to eat lunch, and I turned on the Christian TV, and I heard the Holy Spirit say, this man's about ready to say something you need to hear. He's a minister that I don't listen to him very often. He's from Canada, but he has tremendous healings and miracles. But he's a pastor. He's real soft-spoken. Leon Fontaine. I just remember him. Leon Fontaine. I remember her. Now watch this. I put my stuff down and I crossed my arms and he said this. The same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you.
Amen.
All of a sudden, a revelation hit me.
Amen.
I looked up that word and I found that word, the same power. Now, it wasn't a substitute. Not a diluted. It was the same power 2,000 years ago that raised Christ from the dead actually dwells in each and every one of you. I found out that power. Now watch this. That power is called resurrection power. And then I studied it a little bit farther and I found out that same power, which is called resurrection power, is also actually means a rejuvenating power that will give you the strength and ability to do everything that God asked you to do in your life.
Amen.
And he said this, when you get the revelation of that same power, then syndromes and sicknesses and disease and deficiencies and all these things cannot coexist in your life. Because
yes.
The same power.
Amen.
And I went to Ephesians 2:1 and I just almost had a party by myself. Ye who were dead.
Amen.
And your trespasses and sins
are
now quickened and made alive.
Right.
And I thought, my Lord, that same power.
Yes.
I did. I just walked around one day, just I don't know, a few minutes. The same power.
Yes.
Wow. The same power.
Amen.
The same power.
That's right.
The same power.
That's right.
Wow. Let me put it in some people's references. This is the same power. That Babe Ruth hit the 60th home run. The same bat!
Yeah.
This is the bat!
Same time.
People get a Van Gogh and they pay millions of dollars. This is an original!
Yeah.
Van Gogh painted it with water.
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah. It's the same painting that Van Gogh. This is the painting!
Yeah.
I started thinking, wait a minute, the same power.
Yes.
The same power.
Ooh.
I wish I had something in common with Jesus. I knew that I got the same power.
Yeah.
And if that power is strong enough to take something dead and make it live, it can take something sick and make it well. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to start saying things under your knees. You say, knee, I command you. People go, you think I should go to the doctor? I have people say that right off the bat. I go, absolutely, go right now.
Yeah.
They say, why are you so sure? I said, because if you believed it, you wouldn't have had to ask me.
Right.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I loose the healing power of God. I command the same power that raised Christ from the dead be dwelled in you and your ankle. According to Mark 16:18, I command, yes, Father, by the laying on of hands, you shall be healed now. In Jesus' name, Father. I thank you, Father. If anybody else, Father, in the name of Jesus, if you're watching by YouTube, listen, the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. God sent His word to heal you. So I'm commanding right now, you put whatever is hurting on your body, your hand on that part, if you have a lump, if you have a knot, if you have a scar, if you have pain, I don't care what it is. If you need to start thinking different, you need to put your hand on your mind. If you need to start believing God different, put it on your heart. If you need to talk different, you need to put your hands up next to your mouth. And you just need to say, Father, I thank you the same power that raised Christ from the dead is causing me to be made whole now in Jesus' name. I command people's bodies to be made whole. I command this depression to come off people. This oppression, you don't see no way out. You don't see nothing in your future but what you've been seeing the last. The woman with the issue of blood was hopeless in five areas, but one day she heard of Jesus. Who is Jesus? That's the man that had the power that raised him from the dead that dwells in you. But one day she heard of Jesus, and she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. Five areas she was hopeless in. But when she came into press, behind, she'd been sick for 12 years. It's been all she had, the bread grew worse. But when she touched Jesus, two people knew it. Jesus and she knew it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let me tell you something. When Jesus stops, the whole parade stops.
Yes.
And she knowing what was done in her body. Folks, y'all got to touch Jesus until you know it and He knows it. Come on.
Thank you.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I loose the healing power of God to everybody here at this church.
Healing.
In Madera, California, and all around the world right now on YouTube. We believe the healing power of God, the same power that raised Christ from the dead, dwells in you. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Everybody happy?
Yeah.
Pastor, Michael, listen. I was walking through the house one day, my wife said, what's wrong with you? I said, well, she said a lot nicer. She said, what's wrong with you? I said, nothing. She said, then notify your face. Is everybody happy?
Yeah.
God bless you.
You're happy.